stay.
And having been saved by grace divine, I'm going that way.
I'm going that way. Well,
I'm going that way.
Yes, I'm going that way.
I'm going that way.
And I'm going that way.
And Jesus the Savior.
So I won't spend time, going through what's already in the profile. I'll tell you one or two things that's not in there, since you can find those things in there. Brother Watson, right off the bat, one of the things I can tell you for those who know him, he, if this is the appropriate, he is a no-nonsense kind of preacher. A man who believes that truth must be spoken, And it must be spoken boldly,
yes.
And without fear.
Yes.
And he has been doing that for many, many years in Jamaica, in the States, and different parts of the world. Another thing I want to tell you about Brother Watson is that he is a very effective church planter.
Yes. All right.
This man has planted congregations that have grown to numbers. One of his philosophies about church planting is that you plant a church, when it gets to a certain number, move on to plant another one. And I think that is something that we need probably more. Another thing I want to tell you about Brother Watson is that he's a man of impeccable character and integrity. For all who know Brother Watson, his integrity is just tremendous. I see his wife, Sister Paulette, is sitting there and she's grinning. She knows where that is. And I want to also say, as you will probably see when he comes up, that he's a brother who's an effective and encouraging communicator, preacher of God's word, has been called upon in various parts of the world to preach in campaigns and lectureships. And I was just glad when we were hosting, I said, you need to get Brother Watson here. And it so happens that his topic fits very well with our Sunday morning worship. And so without holding up any more of his time, I ask you to give him your ears and may God be pleased with what he has to share with us today. Brother Watson.
Just over the glory man way, then Brother Lance Watson. Let's get a stand for the song.
Have a home prepared where the saints abide, for in the glory land, and I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angels, man, just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land. There with the mighty hosts I'll stand, just over in the glory land. I am on my way to those mansions fair, just over in the glory land. There to sing God's praise and his glory share, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. I'll join the happy angels. Just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty hosts I'll stand, just over in the glory land. What a joyful thought that my Lord I'll see, just over in the glory land, and with Him may fear there forever. Just over in the glory land, and just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angels, and just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory. If the blood was strong, I would shout and sing, just over in the glory land. And I hosanna to Christ the Lord and King, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angels, and just over in the glory. Just over in the glory land, and just over in the glory land, I'll join
wonderful thought.
Yes.
That we will be here just over in the glory land.
Amen.
I have the sad thought of sharing with you this morning that unless we consider our ways, many of us won't be over there.
Yes.
We'll sing about it and we'll talk about it, but there are other things that, according to the prophet Haggai, needs to be in place.
Yes.
I want to welcome everyone here. It's so great to be here. My spirit has been refreshed and uplifted.
Yes.
And I'm excited and just feel privileged to be sharing God's word with you this morning.
Amen.
As you notice, I had a false start. And you know, in the Olympics these days, you're disqualified right away. But thankfully, you are kind and I have been disqualified so we can continue with our lesson from Haggai chapter 2, verses 11 through to 14. I want to thank our young brother for reading that passage in such a clear and powerful way. And it's good to see our young people walking the path. We need to encourage them and to strengthen them and to build them up, that they become mighty preachers and leaders in the church of our Lord. We will take another read of this passage just to refresh your memory. And unfortunately, I cannot stand still. It's just like that. I got into a lot of trouble as a child.
Thank you.
A lot of trouble as a child because, you know, back in those days, it was like a rule in school that you had to sit and don't move. Or stand still. Why are you fidgeting so much? And I wasn't wired to be still. So you know the result of all of that. Yeah. However, the title of our lesson is very interesting. The title is, Am I Ready for Worship? And it is based on what the prophet said. This is what the Lord Almighty says. Ask the priest what the law says. If a person carries a consecrated meat in the fold of his garment, and that fold touches some bread or stew, some wine, oil, or other food, does it become consecrated? The priest answered, no. Then Haggai said, so it is with this people and this nation in my sight, declares the Lord. Whatever they do and whatever they offer, it is defiled. And you know, that is based upon Leviticus chapter 10 and verse 10, which we'll talk a little bit more of later. The question is asked, what is it that made the people and the nation unclean? It is not as is stated by way of that question that they had touched or come in contact with a dead body. It was something else, but that thing had the same effect as the touching of a dead body. That thing made the person ceremonially unclean and as such unfit to come into the presence of God and to worship God. Your Bible tells you that Israel had put on hold their primary purpose, which was the rebuilding of the temple. They had put that on the back burner and was concentrating on the secondary matter of building their nice residences. As a result of that, we have God's charge. This is what God Almighty says. These people, they say the time has not yet come for the Lord's house to be built. Let me read that again for you. This is what God Almighty says. These people, the Caribbean people, the American people, the Nigerian people, the people from all over the world, these people say the time has not come for the Church of Christ where the Church of Christ is in ruin.
Yes.
Are we together?
Yes.
Our lesson this morning, we will discuss 3 points. We will see that readiness to worship requires a consecrated life that maintains its inner purity and outer purity. Number two, that our readiness for worship requires a holiness that is renewed daily. And in the third place, readiness for worship requires a pure heart that is not contaminated by personal nor communal corruption. By way of history, Israel at that time was the remnant of persons consecrated by God for his work. We may say that it was the second Exodus. We know the first Exodus where God took Israel out of Egypt. Well, in this Exodus, because under the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Israel was scattered and taken as captives down into Babylon. And having served their appointed sentence of 70 years, God raised up certain individuals to return to their homeland, to return to Jerusalem, and to reestablish the center of worship for God. They were given the specific task of rebuilding the temple in Jerusalem. In Ezra 1 and verse 5, we are told that those who returned to Jerusalem were the ones whose heart God had moved. The text says everyone whose heart God had moved prepared to go up and to build the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. They therefore left Babylon by the decree of Cyrus, the king of Persia. Cyrus said, "The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. Any one of his people among you, may his God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem in Judah and build the temple of the Lord, the God of Israel, the God who is in Jerusalem." Among the many things that we learn from that passage is this: that God Almighty is active in the life and the affairs of his people. Yes? And a consciousness on our part of the presence of God will prevent us from slacking off the task he has given to us. Israel did not maintain that consciousness. And as such, while they were raised up to work, they ceased from the work. And God says, by ceasing from the work, they contaminated themselves. Right. And because they were contaminated,
yes, sir,
everything they did,
yes,
was contaminated.
Yes?
Yes? Wow. God Almighty, by his grace now, people, by his grant and his love, he has raised us up in this time to build his church,
yes,
the Church of Christ.
Yes.
And that is for us to build it wherever he plants us.
Amen.
Like Israel, we are to do this task. Why? Because we were consecrated by God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 11, we are reminded of the time of our consecration. We are told, you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. This washing and sanctification and justification took place when we obeyed the gospel of Christ. You remember what Acts chapter 2 and verse 38 tells us?
Oh, yes.
Their son was the dedication, consecration, and justification of the first members of the Lord's church. In Acts 2 and verse 36, we are told that Peter preached that great, fantastic sermon. And the people, when they heard it, they were pricked in their hearts. And they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And Peter responded, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." In verse 41, we are told that those that gladly received his word were baptized. And there were added to them that day about 3,000 souls. When you and I walk in the footsteps of those new converts, when we follow the pattern that is laid out for us in the New Testament scriptures, the same God who saved them at that time will save us in the same way in this time. And your Bible tells you in verse 47 of Acts chapter 2 that the Lord added them to the church, and he was adding them daily because they should be saved. When you and I obey the same gospel, the same God puts us in the same church, and that's the church Jesus declared, "Upon this rock I will build my church." And that church is the church of Christ. Yeah? That's the church of Christ, and that's where your future and my future resides. And being placed in the Lord's church, we have been consecrated for work. In Galatians chapter 6, or rather Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and 27, your Bible says that you are sons of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Yes? "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ did clothe yourself with Christ." You know, I almost feel like preaching this morning. So having said that, now I want you to take note of what Galatians 3:26 says. It says, "You are all sons of God by faith in Christ Jesus." And then it tells you why. You are a child of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Now, why is that important? That is important because we live in a time where people have misunderstood the word of God. Your Bible tells you in John chapter 1 and verses 11 and 12 that Jesus Christ, he came unto his own, and those that were his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become a child of God, our sons of God, our children of God. And that passage has been misused by so many, and consequently has led so many astray. When we read the word of God, it says, those that receive Jesus Christ, they are given the right to become a child of God. The right to become doesn't make you what you would like to become. What it means is that the door has been opened. The path is open for you to exercise that right. Now in Galatians 3:26, we are told of those persons who had exercised that right. When you exercise the right, you are a child of God. No longer to become, but now what you are. And you are a child of God because you have been baptized into Christ. And being baptized into Christ, you have clothed yourself with Christ Jesus. In the clothing of Christ, it's your sanctification, your justification of God. And in Romans chapter 6, 3 and 4, we're told furthermore, Paul says, don't you know? Yes. There are some things we should know. Yes. And we should know it well. Yes. We should know that we know it. Yes. And know that we know it well. Yes. And one such thing is this, that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We therefore were buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may walk in newness of life. You know what Romans chapter 6, verses 3 and 4 tells us there? That's how you obey the gospel.
Amen.
You see, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 to 3 tells us, Paul says, I preach to you the gospel. And what is that gospel? It's the gospel that I received, and it is of first or primary importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the gospel, and that he was buried, and that he rose from the dead on the third day according to the scriptures. Now the death, burial, and resurrection is the gospel. We know that, we understand that. But then in Mark 16 and verse 15, Jesus said to the apostles, go and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believes and is baptized will be saved. Now work with me now. Stay with me. Jesus says, preach the gospel. Those who believe the gospel and are baptized will be saved. So we have to believe the gospel. We have to obey the gospel. Because Hebrews chapter 5 verses 8 and 9 tells us, though he was a son, he learned obedience by the things which he suffered, and being made perfect, he is the author of eternal salvation to those that obey him. So the question now, how do we obey the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Romans chapter 6 tells us that you are baptized into his death. You are buried with him through baptism into death. And you are raised with him to walk in newness of life. This new way of living is inward, outward, and upward. You know what is our challenge today? Is that we are baptized into Christ. But we want to live the old life. Am I right? When we are raised to walk in newness of life, in that new life, we want to bring back, or to bring forward, that old man into the new life. And when we do that, we become unclean before God. And everything that we touch is unclean. Yes? That inward aspect of our new life is keeping a pure heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. A pure heart is a holy life, a soul that is constantly under the blood of Jesus Christ. Outward is our relationship with our community, the saints and the sinners. Yes, that's our outward relationship. With our fellow saints, we are to have a healthy, wholesome relationship. Loving, caring, and sharing. We must be building up and encouraging one another. Upward is our relationship with our Almighty God and our Lord Jesus Christ. This relationship is submissive and obedient, obeying the mandate of our Lord to expand and to grow his kingdom. In Ephesians 4 and verses 15 and 16, we are told that we must be speaking the truth in love. And by so doing, we will in all things grow up into Christ, who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Our passage in Haggai chapter 2 addresses this aspect of our relationship with the divine. It's the upward. It doesn't focus too much on the outward, although it tells us the impact of the outward. The outward impact, the inward, and the inward impacts the upward. Yes? And what is it that troubled that relationship with God? We have neglected the building up of the Lord's temple. And this neglect contaminates us and damages severely our relationship with our God. I want us to take a brief look at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through to 11. Your Bible tells us in that passage how God gives us a powerful reminder of our consecration. And the context tells us that the spiritually unclean will not go to heaven. The contaminated soul is cut off from God. Read with me. Do you not know? You know, there are some things we should know. Do you not know that will not inherit the kingdom of God. Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. You know, I told you that I felt like preaching, brother, yeah? So let me just say this now. So many of us have become so captivated by the ruling of the Supreme Court of the United States. And that ruling is simply regarding homosexuals. Well, I want you to look at your Bible. No, the Supreme Court was just wrong. Am I right? But we're not going to get into the Supreme Court's business. We are about God's business. All right? But here's what I'm saying to you, good folks. You look at what your Bible tells you. It says that the homosexual will not inherit, and that is a practicing homosexual. All right? That they will not inherit the kingdom of God. But that's not the only one that is there. Did you see that? It says the adulterer, and it says the fornicator. And I want to tell you this, folks. There are more adulterers and fornicators in our cause community than there are homosexual persons. Yeah? And it also says, yeah? It also says thieves. Yeah? Not the greedy. Nor slanderers, nor swindlers, none of them will inherit the kingdom of God. So we don't need to get too excited about the Supreme Court. We have our own court of justice. Yes. Our task is to preach the word and to convert everyone, because your Bible tells you God Almighty has already sent out his judgment. And the judgment is this: all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Yes? And verse 11 goes on to say, and this is what some of you were. Did you see the word worthy, brother? Is that past tense? I thank you. You know I have to come to St. Thomas to realize that this is past tense. I thank you, brother. And past tense, when I was in school, you know, so many things have changed now. Yeah? But when I was in school, past tense was used to describe action that has already completed sometime in the long ago. So that's what we were. That's not what we are. You were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit of God. Yes? One reason why the wicked will not inherit heaven is that in that state of wickedness, they cannot do the work of God. And that was what was the state of Israel in Haggai. Yeah? Now notice that those persons, Israel at the time, they were not charged with immorality. Yeah? Their charge, which is our charge, is that just like the wicked, they were not doing God's work. They were charged with misdirected priorities. They became self-centered and not God-centered. Yeah? Our Lord Jesus Christ says, you and I must ensure we don't fall into the same trap. We know that times are challenging materially.
Yes.
Yeah, but it really doesn't matter, good folks. You know, Jesus tells us in Matthew 6 and verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Yes. In Matthew 22 and verse 37, he tells us, we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our strength, and with all our might. And in Matthew 7, 21, he tells us that we must be people of wisdom. So who is the wise man? Whosoever heareth these words of mine and puts them into practice, that's the man that is wise. In Luke 9 and verse 62, he says, no one who has put his hand to the plow and looked back is suitable for the kingdom of God. And I'm now to put out a word to all of you ex-preachers.
Yes, sir.
You know, I have a problem with ex-preachers.
Amen, brother. Yeah? Amen, brother.
When God Almighty called you to preach the word, that's our mission.
Yes, sir.
And that's our task.
Yes, sir.
And when we are carrying out that task,
Amen.
We will suffer persecution.
Yes,
and the churches are here to make sure that we understand what persecution is.
Yes,
but like Jesus who was persecuted, we have to overcome the persecution. Because Jesus said, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. So preachers, I say to you, get back on track. God Almighty called you back then for a work, and he's calling you today for that same work. Yeah? A life that is our center is not ready for worship. Hello. Now remember that our center life in the book of Haggai was misdirected priorities. It was slacking off the work of God. No, God says that the people, they did not say we are not going to do it. They simply said we'll do it tomorrow. And the Lord asked, well, what about today? That's what we mean by misdirected priorities. Yes? And he said, because of those misdirected priorities, they were corrupt, contaminated, and whatever they did was likewise contaminated. Such a life cannot offer worship that is in spirit and in truth to the Almighty God. Number two, get readiness for worship requires a holiness that is renewed daily.
Right.
Our call to holiness is not a whimsical call.
Yes,
we the people of God, we are holy by nature.
Yes.
And that nature was that recreated experience that we had, to use the word of Jesus Christ, that born again experience. When we were born again, birthed by Jesus Christ, given a new lease and life, that is when we were made holy by the blood of Jesus Christ. And so we are holy by nature. We are holy in living. We are holy in our attributes, and we must of necessity be holy in service. Haggai tells us that holiness does not carry, or rather does not have a carry forward priority, properties. Do you like that? What do you mean by carry forward properties? It's like vitamins and minerals. They are very good for the body, am I right? But you know, vitamins and minerals don't have carry forward properties. You cannot take the vitamins and minerals your body is going to need next week. You cannot take it today. Are you with me? You have to take it daily. That's why some bright-minded individuals or persons, they came up and they gave you a list of your daily requirements. Yes? So now, holiness is like that. Holiness has to be renewed daily. Yes? We must renew it through prayer, through feeding on the word. Matthew 4 and verse 4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Will you renew it in summary form by what James, the brother of our Lord Jesus, said in James chapter 4 and verse number 8, draw closer to God and God will draw closer to you. And then here is the other thing, a property of holiness. It is not contagious. Holiness is not contagious. Well, what do we mean by that? It means that if you are holy and you touch me, I don't catch it. It's not passed on like that. In Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 20, this is what your Bible says. The soul who sins is the one who will die. The son will not share the guilt of the father, nor will the father shall share the guilt of the son. Now notice now, the righteousness of the righteous man will be credited to him, and the wickedness of the wicked will be charged against him. Yes? It's not contagious. Each person has to acquire, they have to develop and maintain their own holiness and righteousness before God. That simply means having righteous parents will not make the children righteous. Having a righteous husband will not make the wife righteous. Having a righteous wife will not make the husband righteous. Each one has to give an account of his or her own self before the Almighty God. But here is the converse of that now. Whereas righteousness is not contagious, and whereas righteousness doesn't have carry forward properties, and whereas righteousness or holiness, yes, does not, has to be renewed daily, and cleanness is totally different. Yeah? Haggai said, if a person defiled by contact with a dead body touches one of these things, does it become defiled? And God Almighty says, yes. You know, not only does that give us no individual personal responsibility, but it also underscores communal responsibility. Are you with me?
Yes.
So let's read some further. Yeah? Unlike holiness, uncleanness is contagious. It is like the Ebola virus. If you touch it, you're gone. Yeah? But unlike the Ebola virus, which is spread by contact, yeah? Uncleanness is not like that. You smell it, it's in the ear, it's all around us, yeah? It kills the work of the Lord, and therefore kills our relationship with God. If the man carrying uncleanness touches something, does that thing become unclean? So hold on, you know, brother. I told you I felt like preaching. So, what about in our assembly? You know, we are hugging people. Are we together now? You see, our spirituality is saying to us that apathy, misdirected priorities, lukewarmness, laziness, and such like, all of these things separate us from God and impacts our work. Yes? So let us remind ourselves that Jesus Christ emphasized to us the necessity of obedience. We must be obedient to his word. When sin is in the camp, that's point number three, Brother Terry. Brother Terry, they took 10 minutes off my time and I'm taking it back. Okay. Readiness for worship. Readiness for worship requires a pure heart that is uncontaminated by personal or communal corruption. And what that means, folks, is this. When sin is in the camp, the church cannot go forward. In Joshua chapter 7, your Bible says to Joshua, who his army was defeated by a little small band of men, Joshua spread himself out on the ground before God for the entire day. And then the Lord said, this is not a time for prayer. Yeah? Many times we want to use prayer as a camouflage for repentance. Prayer is not repentance, folks. Yeah? The Lord said to Joshua, stand up. What are you doing on your face? Israel has sinned. They have violated my covenant, which I commanded them to keep. They have taken some of the devoted things. They have stolen. They have lied. They have put them in their possession. That is why they cannot stand against their enemies. Coming forward to the New Testament, your Bible reads in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 6, your glorying is not good. Don't you know that a little leaven leavens the entire lump? Yes? Lack of growth in our churches may be the result of sin in the camp. And the Lord says, consider your ways. You do much, but you get little results. Consider your ways. And the evidence of sin in the camp is manifested in all different ways. You know, you have major evangelistic efforts, but you're bringing in little results. And we have become so accustomed to little results that now we want to justify ourselves. And we say that the reason why we're not having more people baptized is because it is the Lord who gives the increase. So we must not use baptism as a mark of our effectiveness. When I'm telling you, old folks, you know, I am not here to make friends. I'm just going to tell you what I understand my Bible to say. My Bible says we are to go into the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them into the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And my Bible tells me that when the apostles carried that out, Jesus Christ was in the numbering business. Yeah? He says 3,000 were baptized that day. And then further on, he says there were 5,000. And further on, he says multitudes. Are we together? Now, what about this notion that it is the Lord who gives the increase? Well, that's what your Bible says. But your Lord, our Lord, is in the increasing business. Yeah? So when we put on the work, the Lord gives the increase. When there is no increase, consider your ways. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 9, verse 56 and 57, I think, he says, the harvest is plentiful. It is the laborers that have few. So this notion that we're planting the word, we have been planting the word for 40, 50, 60 years. It's harvest time. And when we're not getting harvest, we have to consider our ways.
Drink again.
Yes, man. That's telling the truth.
Drink again.
So that being the case, church leaders and preachers, let's get back in the converting business. In the parable of the sower, you remember that great parable? The good seed, it brings forth fruit. It multiplies. Some 30-fold, some 60-fold, some 100-fold. You know, surprisingly, there's no 10-fold and there's no 20-fold. The good seed, the lowest number that I can recall is 30. So it seems, and I will tell you how I take that personally. That just lands that personally. Are we together?
Yes.
That means to me, 30 is my minimum requirement for the year. Are we together? 30 is my minimum requirement for the year. And the year where I don't make minimum requirement, it's time for me to do what? Consider your means.
Yes, my glory. You're helping us.
And we are all educated. You know, we're highly educated people. Have you noticed that, brother? Yeah. We have a Lord. God has just blessed us tremendously. We are more educated now than ever before. We have more tools now than ever before. Yeah? We have more resources now than ever before. So those of us, your Bible says, to whom much is given, much is required. So I have to upgrade my 30 because God has given me much. Am I the only one?
No.
There is a divine call for repentance in the churches of Christ. Here's what God says. I struck all the work of your hands with blight, mildew, and hail, yet you did not return to me. Yeah? Declares the Lord. Acts 17 and 30, the times of ignorance God overlooked. But now he commands all men everywhere to repent. We have considered, am I ready for worship? We have seen that to be that readiness for worship requires three things. Yeah? It requires a consecrated life that maintains its inner and outer purity. Number two, it requires a holiness that is renewed daily. And number three, it requires a pure heart that is not contaminated by personal nor communal corruption. Are you ready for worship? Okay. We all ought to be. And if you're not ready, the Lord is calling you to repentance.
Amen.
To the unsaved, the Lord says, he's calling you to be washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. He's calling you to exercise your right to become a child of God. And how do you do that? It's very simple. Believe in Jesus. Repent of your sins. Confess your faith in him. And obey his command to be baptized for the remission of your sins. Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is calling you today. Will you come? If you need to rededicate your life to Christ, we encourage you to do that at this hour. If you are outside of Christ, please come. You're having problems with your marriages, you have problems with your family, you're having problems with yourself, you're having problems all different kinds of ways. Come to the Lord. Yes? You may want the church to pray for you. We encourage you to do that. Whatever it is that is your spiritual state, we want to encourage you that you don't leave here today and you're not in a right relationship with God. So we're going to stand and sing the invitation song. And we encourage you to make that decision that draws you to God. Are you washed in his blood? Are you saved? Be saved. Thank you.
Have you a heart that's weary?
My Jesus,
yes, do you?
Father, we approach your throne of mercy and grace, thanking you for the